This is a microphone that I have custom made. If you're wondering how it sounds, well, you're listening to it right now. Not too bad for a homemade microphone, huh? The best part is, it wasn't even that complex to make. I mean, it only took a few components to put on the circuit board to make this whole thing work. And really, the secret lies in this tiny little piece right here, which is called the microphone capsule. So stick around for this video, because in this video, I'll show you how this thing works and how you can make one of your own. So, let's dive in.
The final schematic for this project is in the description. Let's start with perhaps the most basic form of a microphone that other YouTube videos will show you. Here is this tiny electret capsule. This electret microphone is a type of condenser microphone, as opposed to dynamic microphones. Electrets are different from other condenser types because they are permanently polarized internally. Well, what does that even mean? Well, let's take a closer look at what goes into an electric microphone exactly. Inside each microphone is a sort of suspended capacitor. When you talk or make noise, the sound waves come and move the plates of this capacitor, thus changing the overall capacitance. We can convert this into electric signals by looking at one of the more basic capacitor equations. Charge equals capacitance multiplied by voltage. The electret is permanently polarized, meaning that it has a constant charge Q. That leaves us with a changing capacitance and voltage. When the sound waves push the plates closer together, the capacitance increases. This forces the voltage to decrease in order to keep the charge constant. The inverse is also true. When the plates vibrate away, the capacitances decrease and the voltage increases. And so yes, we will get a voltage representation of our sound waves across the pins of the capsule. But wait, we can't use the signal just yet, because the signal is both very high impedance and very low voltage. In order to make it more usable, we have to create an impedance converter. Most of the time, this so-called impedance converter is in the form of a JFET. This kind of transistor is useful because of its high impedance input, which will match the high impedance output of our capsule. Likewise, the output of the JFET is low impedance. This makes our output signal much easier to work with. Sometimes the JFET already comes with the capsule, like in our case with our cheap capsule, so you won't have to worry about getting one yourself. What you will have to do, however, is to add power to our JFET impedance converter so that it may convert our audio signal. This is often done through a somewhat large resistor, like a 10K, for example, attached like shown. For this circuit, I will be using a 9-volt source for this example. Now this whole circuit will work, and we will get our audio signal from the JFET, but we still have this rather inconvenient DC offset from a 9-volt power source on the output. This can be easily solved by adding a capacitor on the output to filter this DC out. The value of this capacitor depends on how low of a frequency you are willing to filter out. But for this example, I'll stick with a 10 microfarad capacitor for now. And as you can see on my oscilloscope, we are able to successfully detect and measure our audio signal. It is still much too weak to use yet, and that's where we can use a microphone preamplifier. This specific preamplifier is essentially just an op-amp circuit that will raise our audio signal up to line levels so that the computer's ADC will be able to read it properly. I'll be using the NE5532 audio op-amp for this purpose. I will use a 10K and a 51K resistor in order to get a 5x amplification.
And well, this is how it sounds. So it's probably not good enough to be used in my future videos.
We can actually improve upon this idea and improve the performance even further. The first thing that we can do is to introduce a higher quality electret capsule. JLI Electronics is perhaps one of the better distributors of these capsules. For my project, I've selected the JLI 2590A. Because it has the required JFET already built in. You can see it labeled as this FET impedance converter in the schematic. If you want to follow along, but get a microphone without the impedance converter built in, simply purchase an external JFET and attach it to the diagram like shown. The only external components I used for my specific capsule were these 10K and 2K2 resistors, which I followed from the datasheet's recommendations. Now, let's investigate the next stage, which is the preamplifier. This time around, I will be using the TL-071 op-amp instead. The special thing about this op-amp is that it also has these JFET inputs. This time, I will also use the TLE-2426 as my voltage divider. This should make the voltage division just a little bit easier and more precise. On the output, I used a 10 microfarad capacitor. and attached it to a single-ended audio jack. Before I attached the capsule, I used my function generator to make sure that everything was working. And yes, we can clearly hear both the sine wave and the square wave coming through. After attaching the capsule,
this is how it sounds.
With the confidence that I gained from making this prototype, I decided to start work on a PCB board. This time around, however, I planned to make it fully integrated with XLR. And to do that, we need to supply another output and also receive the 48-volt phantom power from the audio interface. Well, what exactly do we need to do to get the second output? Basically, XLR uses two outputs in order to reduce noise. The outputs are identical to each other, except that one of them is the exact opposite of the other. Then, when the two signals reach the audio interface, they are both put into a differential amplifier. This will remove the difference between the two and restore the original audio signal. Why is this important? Well, let's imagine that there's a significant amount of noise on the line from interference in the air. This interference will affect both outputs the exact same. Then, when the outputs reach the differential amplifier, the interference will cancel itself out, leaving only the original audio signal intact. This XLR setup was rather useful, and luckily there's an easy way that we can implement it. I upgraded the TL-071 to a TL-072. It's the exact same thing, except that it has two op amps on the same chip. All I did was feed the original audio signal from the first op amp into the second. The second op amp was configured as an inverting amplifier, so it would invert the signal as required by XLR. Make sure to use another decoupling capacitor here as well. All that's left is to receive the phantom power. And here is how phantom power is wired internally in most audio interfaces. The 48 volts is split to both lines through 6.8K resistors. On our side of the circuit, we can place our own resistors and combine the phantom power again. I use two 1K resistors. It's up to you at this point for regulation, but I opted for a 12-volt Zener diode to act as my regulator. Make sure to place the capacitors here as well to stabilize the voltage. And that should complete the circuit. And after assembling it, it didn't work as expected. There were some serious issues with audio quality in the recording. And after some debugging, I found a few issues with the circuit. First, there is a 32 kHz oscillation in the power supplied from the Zener diode. At first, I thought that I could fix this with a couple of capacitors, but to no avail. Afterwards, I found another issue. The voltage across the Zener was only 7 volts. This is likely what is causing my other issues. I believe that this is because I'm drawing too much current through the phantom power. And, as you know, more current means more voltage drop, which means there's not enough voltage to drop through the Zener. Placing some larger decoupling capacitors along the Zener in the virtual ground definitely helped a great deal. But the circuit still isn't perfect. If you're wondering how it sounds at this point, let's do a quick comparison. So far, aside from the intro, I've been using my normal microphone, the AT2020. And here is what the DIY microphone sounds like. It's far from professional, and the biggest problem is the background noise. But I'd say it's good for a first attempt. This is what I think may need improvement in the design. The captured audio sounds good in and of itself, but somewhere in the preamp, a significant amount of noise is being injected. I have a few ideas of what the source might be, which I may test for a second version. First, the phantom power isn't providing enough voltage to keep the Zener at 12 volts, which I had hoped for. Second, these TL-072 op amps are pretty noisy, so they may be contributing some of the parasitic noise. Either way, I'm still happy with the result, since it definitely has some really good potential for improvement. To top off the whole project, I 3D printed this microphone body so that I can easily hold it, just like I did back in the intro. It comes in three pieces. The main body with an XLR attachment at the bottom, the middle piece which attaches onto the main body and also holds the third piece, which is the structure which holds the electronics in place. I would have liked to attach a mesh on the outside, but that was unsuccessful at the time of recording this video. Like I said, this whole project has potential for improvement.
That should just about cover it for this microphone. It's surprisingly simple and affordable if you'd like to give it a try yourself. Anyways, thanks for watching. If you've enjoyed this video, please consider subscribing so that you can see my future videos. Also, check out my Buy Me a Coffee page so that you can support this channel so that I can keep making these videos. Anyways, thanks for watching. See you in the next one.